Hello and welcome to A Tactical History of Liverpool. We meet up with Liverpool over a year after the Watford debacle, as they prepared to face Bayern Munich in the quarterfinals of the Intercities Fairs Cup. It was at around the same time as Liverpool that Bayern emerged as the club that we know today. Founded in 1900 as its members split from a gymnastics club, Bayern was successful yet far from an all-conquering force in their early days. They won some regional competitions, winning both the Bavarian and Southern German championships multiple times, but it wasn't until 1932, under the management of Richard Dombey-Kuhn, that Bayern would finally win a national title. Far from the start of a glorious new era, everything would come tumbling down for Bayern less than a year later. The rise of the Nazis to power in 1933 forced many changes upon the club. Their president Kurt Landauer, youth director Otto Bier, and coach Dombey were all Jewish, and so were forced to resign from their positions. As a result, Bayern fell into decline, bouncing around mid-table in the Bavarian and Southern leagues, verging on bankruptcy in the late 1950s. A poor performance at the 1962 World Cup saw the German FA realise they were falling behind other countries, so in response they finally formed a national league, the Bundesliga, and approved new rules on professionalism, yet Bayern had since fallen so far that they weren't even chosen to take part. It wasn't until 1965 that Bayern would be promoted to the Bundesliga, but by then things had started to fall into place for them. Spurred on by youngsters friends Beckenbauer, Sepp Maier and Gerd Müller, they won the German Cup in their first season after promotion, retained it the next season, as well as winning the European Cup Winners' Cup, then won the Bundesliga for the first time as they completed a league and cup double in 1969. By the time we meet them in March 1971, Udo Lettek had taken over as coach, now in his first full season in charge, and he had further strengthened the team by adding the likes of Paul Breitner and Uli Hoeneß. Bayern lined up in a 4-3-3 shape. The Liverpool side they faced was a new one. There were a whopping 8 changes from the team we saw in episode 26, with only Chris Lawler, Emlyn Hughes and Alun Evans surviving. Replacing Tommy Lawrence in goal was Ray Clemence. Born in Skegness, which he described as a backwater when it came to football, Clemence had an unsuccessful trial with Notts County as a teenager, but was instead spotted by Scunthorpe United after playing at their ground for his local team in a County Cup final. Clemence would turn professional on his 17th birthday, and despite starting it in Scunthorpe's third team, would make his debut for the first team that season. The next year, Clemence would become their first choice goalkeeper, aged just 18. "All I can remember was that I had a lot to do," he recalled. "Scunthorpe was struggling a bit, so I suppose that helped me. Maybe if we were doing well, I wouldn't have played or had less to deal with in games." Kept busy near the bottom of the third division, Clemence was given plenty of chances to showcase his ability, and he soon caught the eye of new Liverpool scout Jeff Twentyman. The 18-year-old was signed at the end of that season, with Bill Shankly going out of his way to win him over. "Personally, I couldn't believe that Liverpool were making so much of an effort to impress me," said Clemence. "It made me feel like I was part of the club already, before I'd even signed." Clemence was brought to the club on false pretenses, though.
"When Shank signed me, I went across there and I didn't really need any persuading, but sat in front of the great man. I remember him saying to me that we've watched you a lot of times, and he said, you're improving all the time. He said, we think you can play for England," he said. "And he also said, you'll be in the side within a year," he said. "Tommy Lawrence is past 30, past his best, and you keep improving the way you are doing," he said, "you'll be in the side within the next year." So I went back home to Skegness, which is my hometown, proud as punch. I signed for Liverpool. Talked to my mother and father about playing the first division in maybe 6 months' time. Came back for pre-season. Within 2 weeks, I found that Tommy Lawrence wasn't 30. He was 27, playing the peak of his career, and I had to wait 2.5 years to get in the side.
Shanks was not a goalkeeper person, said Ian St. John. He thought they were from a different planet. "I watched Ray more often than any other player I bought, because he was a goalkeeper," admitted Shankly. With their reluctance to change a winning team, it was already hard enough to break into Liverpool's starting 11, so goalkeepers had to go the extra mile to convince Shankly.
"We played a German team and we were 8-0 up from the first leg, you see. Now Shanks, as you well know at that time, had the team and that was that. He was reluctant to bring anybody else in. But Clem's there on the bench. Now we're going to win the second leg, 8-0 up. And Bob Paisley said, well, will we give young Clemence a game, you know, and Shanks, oh, wait, Bob, you know, too early for this." So Clem's on the bench and Ian Callaghan scored right away in the second leg. So we're 9-0 up, you know. So Bob went, we'll put Clemence on. Oh, hang on, Bob. So finally, with 10 minutes to go, you know, Shanks said, what do you think? He said, well, we'll put Clemence on. And Bob went with the sponge, yeah. Threw the sponge out, oh no. So, I mean, I don't think Shanks fancy putting him on, that's for sure.
That was obviously well thought. Well thought.
Rather than going directly into the first team, Clemence instead spent years in the reserves honing his craft as part of Liverpool's Central League winning side. "I quickly realised how high the standards were," he said. "In some ways, I was the first player of his kind that learned the Liverpool way in the reserves. Shanks knew not to throw people in at the deep end, but in the meantime, I was learning how to swim, so the system worked well." The Watford loss called for a changing of the guard though, so Clemence was finally given his shot in the big leagues. He was an immediate success, and much of Shankly's praise for him suggested he perhaps regretted not bringing the goalkeeper through sooner.
"If the 60s team had had Ray Clemence in goal, they'd have won the European Cup and all the cups under the sun. Because I see that because I think Ray Clemence has been one of the greatest goalkeepers of all time. And if it had been in that 60s team, I don't think that anybody could possibly have beaten us."
Despite not being particularly tall or muscular, Clemence knew how to handle himself, which he credited to working with Jeff Sidebottom at Scunthorpe, whereas training alongside Tommy Lawrence at Liverpool taught him how to sweep up behind his defence. Combined with his cat-like reflexes and mental capacity to concentrate during the long periods where he had little to do, Liverpool had a complete goalkeeper on their hands. Ahead of him at centre-back was Larry Lloyd. The Bristolian was a rare southerner in the Liverpool team, although, as one of 10 children born to a blind father, he likely had the strong mentality Shankly was looking for in his dressing room. A talented enough sportsman to be selected to play basketball for England, football was Lloyd's real passion, and at the age of 14 he became the first ever associate schoolboy to sign for his boyhood club Bristol Rovers. It would be several years before Lloyd became a professional though. In the meantime, he had a day job as a steel worker, training with Rovers in the evenings. "I was really happy when I was off the football pitch," he recalled. Lloyd would occasionally take sick days from this job, carefully choosing the dates to coincide with when assistant manager Bill Dodgin was available, as he would provide Lloyd with one-to-one coaching and regaled him with stories of his career that made the youngster even more determined to make it as a professional. Lloyd would finally turn pro in 1967, but he would only play for the reserves in his first season. The wider trend towards a back four helped him though, as the next year he lined up alongside teammate Stuart Taylor, rather than competing with him for a place. Whereas Taylor was more of a gentlemanly defender, Lloyd was a self-described hard, tough, fearless bastard who would tackle as if his life depended on it. With Liverpool thinking about long-term replacements for Ron Yeats, the strong left-footed Lloyd was a clear match. In one of his first meetings with a centre-back, Shankly remarked that Lloyd gave the impression he would kick his grandmother for a fiver. Lloyd's response was that he would do it for half of that. Making over 50 appearances in his debut season, he was given plenty of opportunities to catch the eyes of scouts, including Liverpool's 20-man. It was after a trip to Hartlepool that Liverpool made their move. "I had probably the worst game I ever had in my professional career," remembered Lloyd. When I asked Jeff why he still signed me after that performance, he told me that he knew my intentions were good, but it wasn't coming off for me. He also said he believed I couldn't play any worse. That speaks volumes for Jeff 20-man, because he wasn't put off by one bad game. He'd obviously watched me months and months before, and he'd already done his homework. Liverpool had actually wanted to sign Lloyd earlier, but manager Fred Ford, a close friend to Shankly, was reluctant to let him go until Rovers had secured safety. They had a mediocre season in the third division, yet managed a decent run in the cup, culminating in a fifth round tie with Everton. While on Merseyside, Ford arranged for the team to have a look around Melwood and meet Shankly, giving the Scot the opportunity to eye up a clueless Lloyd in the flesh. By April, Rovers were safe, and so Liverpool came back to discuss Lloyd's future, signing him for £50,000. Lloyd endured a difficult start to his life on Merseyside. He reported a less welcoming atmosphere upon his arrival at the club than Clemence did, with Liverpool's senior players perhaps more aware that the new boys were providing direct competition for places than they had been a couple of years earlier. Although Lloyd stated, "I knew Jeff and Shanks had a lot of confidence in me and that settled me down straight away. The death of his beloved father wouldn't have made the situation any easier." Lloyd made a handful of appearances early on in his first season in red, when Yeats was missing for injury, but he had to wait until after the Watford game to become first choice. From then on, his place was undisputed though, missing just two games in the 70-71 season. Partnering Lloyd in the centre of Liverpool's defence was returning Tommy Smith. With Yeats now bumped down the pecking order, it was Smith that took over his role as captain. "I had skipped beside on previous occasions when Ron Yeats wasn't available, but this was different," he said. "Shanks was of the mind that I had qualities of leadership, and when he asked if I would accept the captaincy on a permanent basis, he barely got his words out before I said yes. I felt it a great honour and privilege to captain Liverpool. It was not a nominal position, the role carried with it real responsibility, and I was determined to carry out my duties to the best of my ability." Yeats was one of the first to congratulate Smith. "Always remember this," the Scot advised, "whatever goes wrong during a game, it's not your fault, even when it is." "How come?" Smith asked. Because you're the captain, Yeats replied. If a team concedes a goal, look about for the player who is looking most guilty and blame him. Does it work? Well, it worked for me for 9 years. To their left was Alec Lindsay. Lindsay had joined Liverpool a month before Lloyd from Bury, where he had spent 4 years after turning professional at 17, helping his local team to get promoted to the second division. He struggled after making the move to Merseyside though, tried in various positions to little success and even having a transfer request accepted. I didn't know whether I was in a dream or a nightmare, he recalled. I don't think I spoke for 12 months. I was overawed by Bill and the whole thing. I still find it hard to believe that Liverpool signed me from Bury. It was a bolt of lightning because one minute I was watching them in Europe on the TV, and the next minute I was sharing a dressing room with all these great players. On the first day I sat next to Roger Hunt and I was thinking, what the bloody hell am I doing here? There's an oft-repeated story from this period of Shankly demanding more from Lindsay, wanting him to take men on, go past them and score goals like he had at Bury, to which confused Lindsay replied, but that wasn't me, that was Jimmy Kerr. Shankly promptly turned to Bob Paisley and explained that they had bought the wrong player. Lindsay flatly denies it though, saying Shanks knew exactly who I was. It's a joke if you think about it. I don't think Shanks would make a mistake about signing someone. Brought in as a midfielder then spending most of his first season in the reserves as a forward, it wasn't until Liverpool had a problem at left back but needed filling that Lindsay finally settled. From this new position he could make use of his wonderful left foot.
One of the best left foots I think I've ever seen. Alec was one of those players that had such a lovely sweet movement and motion when he kicked the ball with his left foot that he could kick it three quarters of the length of the pitch. And he made it look so easy. And that's always the sign of a good player, when they make it look easy.
Probably had one of the best left foots I've ever seen, along maybe with him and Kevin Sheedy. Absolutely terrific with him.
Lloyd had bumped Yeats out to fullback, yet Lindsay's emergence really spelled the end for the legend's Liverpool career. When he did play, Yeats had to endure excruciating pain from a back injury.
I was unfortunate. I was 33. I had a slipped disc 2 years before that. I was playing every game in agony with a slipped disc, so I was ready for the off. And I'll give him his due, you know, he asked if I wanted to join the staff. You know, he'd send me to Lillishaw, do the coaching and that. And I think I was stupid not to take his offer, you know, but I just thought, well, I'll get better and I'll keep playing because I was very fit. And I think it was the worst decision I ever made in my life, you know.
Playing ahead of Lindsay on the left was Steve Heighway. Born in Dublin to English parents, he didn't even play football until the age of 10 when his parents returned to England. Although he was a keen Sheffield United supporter, Heighway never had any grand dreams of mimicking his heroes. Even when Manchester City invited him to train with them as a teenager, he had no plans of becoming a professional footballer. Instead, he was going to go to university and train to become a teacher. While at Warwick University, he played for the English and British University side, which was managed by Roy Rees. Rees also coached amateur side Skelmersdale United, and so he invited Heighway to play for them. Heighway excelled in the Cheshire League, managing around 20 goals in each of his seasons with Skem despite playing as a winger. Although he was obviously committed, often having to hitchhike to games, he never considered it anything more than a bit of fun. Little did he know that his exploits had been noticed by Liverpool, allegedly tipped off by Bob Paisley's sons, and then further scouted by Tony Waiters and Ronnie Moran. Towards the end of his final year at university, Shankly arrived at his digs to offer him a contract. Whereas most players Shankly negotiated with couldn't sign quick enough, Heighway instead wanted assurances over his wages and time to think it over. For once in his life, Bill Shankly wasn't preaching to the converted, he recalled. If I was playing hard to get, it was because I was not convinced that professional football was the career I wanted to pursue. He eventually agreed, though, on the basis that he would return to his teacher training if he didn't make it as a footballer. Given many of Highway's teammates initially struggled to cope with Liverpool's training, it's hardly surprising the winger found a step up from the amateurs difficult. I didn't find training particularly easy, but I was never a natural trainer, he said. I could run and run all day, but I'd never done any proper training in my life. I just played loads and loads of football and learnt my skills there. I never even trained with Skelmersdale because I lived so far away. Nevertheless, as Peter Thompson was struggling with injuries and Bobby Graham broke his leg early on in the season, Heighway didn't go through the long process of learning the Liverpool way in the reserves as his teammates had. Within months he was starting, and not long after he was called up to represent Ireland. This was a man that not even a year before had no plans of becoming a professional footballer, and now he was the centre of attention at one of the country's biggest clubs. That first season, things were going too far and too fast for me, he admitted. It was all a bit dazzling, not to mention embarrassing at times, as I saw my name in the headlines and did interviews on radio and television. Highway immediately impressed with his raw and direct attacking.
Oh yes, it's deceptive. Yeah. But of course, fastness and cleverness come together. He's so clever with the ball that makes him look fast.
Yeah. What about, he seems to me a very strong player. He takes knocks. Once or twice he was brought down and he seems to show no effect of being kicked at all, you know, from behind. He just gets on with the game. Is he particularly tough?
Well, he's got Celtic blood in his veins. Put it that way.
Following Peter Thompson, we had a different style of winger. We had Stevie Highway, who was very direct, and you couldn't get more direct than Stevie. He would had the, he had this high-stepping running action, you know, knees up, and he would get the ball and knock it, and he would fly. And it was a great sight to see him racing down the left-hand side of the field and whipping in the crosses.
Highway wasn't the only university graduate in the team, though. Partnering Emlyn Hughes in the middle was Brian Hall. Born in Glasgow but raised in Preston, Hall had trials with local side North End, as well as Blackburn Rovers and Bolton Wanderers as a team, but the only place he really wanted to go was Liverpool, albeit not for the football. A self-described Beatles nut, he arrived in the city in 1965 to study maths at the university. Unbeknownst to him, a friend had written to the club to arrange a trial, so Hall found himself signed up as an amateur after impressing. Unlike Highway, Hall was more sure of his desire to become a professional footballer. A throwaway comment about turning pro during the final year of his course was jumped upon by coach Reuben Bennett, insisting he couldn't quit his studies, and although retrospectively Hall realised Bennett had only intended to encourage him and underline the importance of education, at the time Hall took it as a sign that Liverpool weren't interested in him as a player. Feeling out his options, he went to Liverpool legend Billy Liddle, a bursar at Liverpool University, to ask whether he had any contacts further down the levels of the professional game. Within weeks, Shankly called Hall into his office and offered him terms. He made his debut towards the end of the 68-69 season and managed another appearance for next season, but it wasn't until Ian Callaghan suffered an injury in September 1970 that Hall really broke through into the first team. He was very much the kind of player the Liverpool system was aiming to develop. Unspectacular, but doing the simple things very well. Intelligent, hard-working and deceptively tough for his small stature. Highway and Hall were reportedly nicknamed Big and Little Bamba after University Challenge presenter Bamba Gascoigne. Although Highway insists this was a media invention, none of the lads in the squad ever referred to us by those names. They were far worse than that. This media interest in the handful of university graduates breaking into football in the 70s was part of a wider attempt to make the sport more appealing to the middle classes. The graduate invasion was always more publicity than serious assertion, said Professor Stephen Wagg. It was a good selling line aimed at a potential middle class supporter, but also to legitimate the game in the eyes of advertisers. On the right was Phil Boersma. Born in Kirby, the local lad was brought through Liverpool's youth system, joining in 1965 and making his first appearance for the reserves as an 18-year-old in 1967. It took nearly two more years for Boersma to make his debut for the first team, and even then he was still forced to wait for regular playing time, sent out on loan to Wrexham in the meantime, before finally establishing himself as a first-teamer in November 1970. Although typically a forward, Boersma was also played in midfield. "You would play anywhere for them," he said. "I would have played left wing, right wing, up front, anywhere." Up front was Alun Evans. Having already missed a large chunk of the previous season after getting glassed in a nightclub, Evans's fitness woes continued, needing an operation after picking up an injury in an earlier round against Dynamo Bucharest. This was his first start back, having returned 4 days earlier as a substitute against Tottenham. He was partnered by John Toshack. With both Evans and Graham ruled out early in the season, Shankly was forced into entering the transfer market, signing Toshack from Cardiff for a club record £110,000 in November 1970. Toshack was a natural sportsman, captain of his school's baseball, cricket and rugby teams. However, football was his real love. He was already playing for his school's under-11s team at the age of 8, and aged 15 he scored 47 goals in 22 appearances for his local team, earning a spot in the Welsh boys' side. These performances saw him earn a trial with Tottenham, only to be rejected. And although Leeds and Wolves offered him trials too, he turned them down, instead signing amateur forms with boyhood side Cardiff City. This afforded Toshack the opportunity to work alongside his hero, Welsh legend John Charles. "I totally idolised him," recalled Toshack, "and then there I was, playing a couple of matches with him in the Cardiff City second team. I trained with him, I observed him, I observed how he headed a ball, I cleaned his boots." Playing with Charles wasn't just a dream come true for Toshack, but had real practical benefits. Both big hulking strikers, Toshack and Charles had a very similar style of play, so Toshack had learned how to refine this game directly from one of the best. He made an enormous impression on me, Toshack said. He used to give me little tips in training sessions. Charles's career was coming to an end at this point though, his knees beginning to give in, so this opened a path into the first team for Toshack. He made his debut age just 16 for the club, and over the next 5 years he would score over 100 goals for them. Toshack was a big boy, but now he was playing against men, seasoned pros fighting for survival in the second division. I always felt it was about brain more than brawn, he said. If I fought my way around the field with intelligence, I could overcome the more physical aspects of the game. Toshack's time at Cardiff also gave him plenty of European experience too, as Cardiff winning the Welsh Cup saw him qualify for the European Cup Winners' Cup, nearly making the final in 1968. Scoring plenty of goals, it was inevitable that Toshack would begin to draw attention from elsewhere. However, evidence suggests that Liverpool hadn't been keeping tabs on him for long when they signed him. 20-man scouting diary contains just two reports, both from games in the weeks leading up to his signing. Best display to date, 3 goals, good enough Division 1, and very good in the air, does a job we want. Best display to date suggests it wasn't the first time Andy Beattie, the report's author, had watched him, although Liverpool's injury situation likely hurried the scouting process. A club record fee would always be a risk, but a youngster scoring bucket loads of goals in the second division and Europe seems an easy bet for a team needing a striker in a rush. Liverpool's injury crisis meant Toshack was immediately thrown into the first team rather than acclimatising in the reserves, making his debut just 3 days after signing. There was no pampering at Liverpool, he said. It was sink or swim. It was tough early on, I must admit, and I found the step up very difficult. The expectation of a cop week in, week out made the step up difficult, but that's what happens when you play for a big club. It was one of the first things Shankly had warned Toshack of upon meeting him.
Welcome to Liverpool Football Club, son. You've left Sunday school and you've come to church. That was his way of telling me the move that I'd made.
Toshack's adaptation wasn't helped by him picking up an ankle injury in the days leading up to his signing. I was terrified that the deal would fall through, but Shanks assured me that it didn't affect his plans, he remembered. I played my first game for Liverpool against Coventry just 3 days later when I shouldn't have. They really wanted to get me fit to play, so I played and I struggled a little bit, and Bill and Bob Paisley could see it. With so many changes to the team, a new era was underway at Liverpool. The keen-eyed among you may have just noticed that the cop is now to the right of the cameras, whereas in previous episodes it's been to their left. Beforehand, the cameras had been under the Kemlin Road roof. However, reconstruction work was being done on the main stand, including the installation of a new television gantry, and this match saw it used for the first time, switching the view. Playing towards the cop in the first half, Liverpool started the match at a high tempo. They pressed Bayern high up the pitch, showcasing the energy of their new younger recruits. These weren't just individuals taking it in turns to chase their men though, but coordinated efforts to corner Bayern and win back the ball. Liverpool's attacking quartet would each pick up one of Bayern's back four, pressuring the man on the ball, but also his teammates to limit his passing options. Liverpool's midfielders would also push up to cover behind them in support, as would their fullbacks. Liverpool's players would also work hard to retreat quickly too, getting back behind the ball to stop Bayern from countering, also counter-pressing, attempting to win the ball as soon as they lost it. The result was that Bayern found it nearly impossible to play out. Their attackers were for the most part anonymous, with Gerd Müller probably the most involved, and even that was because he kept dropping deep into midfield, far from the goal-scoring positions Bayern ideally wanted him in. The closest thing Bayern got to any success was having their fullbacks push forward out wide, and even that didn't really actually threaten the home side. With Bayern incapable of getting anything going, Liverpool were in complete control. Tommy Smith was stepping forward into midfield as usual. Brian Hall pushed forward to join the attack. And Phil Boersma was proving a nuisance on the right. It was Steve Heighway on the left that Bayern were having most trouble with though. Willing to cut inside or go down the outside, the Irishman's dribbling saw him race past defenders, and although he sometimes overran it, he was consistently posing a danger to his opponents. Half an hour in, Liverpool took the lead. A sloppy touch by Reyna's Obel gave away the ball, and Alec Lindsay quickly fed it to Heighway. He beat Johnny Hansen down the outside to cross, and Alun Evans, moving away from goal, took a touch and turned to face the cop in one smooth motion, before firing an inch-perfect finish inside the far post. They then doubled their lead minutes into the second half. Lindsay crossed towards the back post at a free kick, where Chris Lawler headed the ball back towards goal, and Evans scrambled the ball across the line before Sepp Maier could get to it. Despite building a comfortable lead, Liverpool didn't let up. They continued to harass and pressure Bayern, and kept threatening the defence whenever possible, refusing to slow down. Liverpool's defenders still wouldn't give Bayern an inch, and the few times Ray Clemence was called into action, he pounced on them immediately, despite having had so little to keep him occupied. Nearing the end of the game, Evans completed his hat-trick. Meyer caught a cross, but when he threw it out, Liverpool once again swarmed the recipient. Emily Hughes won back the ball, evaded a challenge and shot at goal. Meyer saved it, but spilled the ball at the feet of Evans to finish. After 4 months out, Evans had returned in the best way possible, scoring 3 goals to all but guaranteed Liverpool's place in the next round. It proved to be his finest moment in a Liverpool shirt, said Toshack. All the talk in the newspapers was about Munich and how Liverpool was going to cope with Müller, but in the end, the tie was over before we got on the plane to Germany for the second leg. One of the biggest disappointments to me turned out to be Bayern Munich, recalled Heighway. They had such a big name and so many great players in their ranks, Beckenbauer and all, but it was almost an anti-climax when we rolled them up in the first leg at Anfield. This was a Liverpool team in transition, but making such easy work of a team like Bayern was an early indication of what these new players were capable of. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe to support the channel. You can get updates on what I'm doing by following on Twitter and Facebook, links are in the description, but most importantly by supporting Holding Midfield on Patreon. Without financial support, I can't justify the time it goes into making these videos to keep the channel alive while also receiving access to premium content. Thanks for watching.